Good evening. Welcome to Emmanuel Mennonite Church for our Christmas Eve service. We know that COVID has impacted our lives a lot, and no sooner do we think we have a rhythm, and the rhythm gets disrupted, and we have a new flow of rules and regulations. And so even though the numbers may be smaller, we know that we are meeting in that spirit. If you are watching the recording, or if you're visitors here, my name is Fran, and I'm the interim administrative lead pastor until our full-time pastor, Rod Suderman, comes from Saskatoon. He'll be glad to be warming up. Christmas means so many things to so many people, and tonight my prayer is that we can come together to celebrate and focus on the birth of a small baby boy named Jesus. Years before his arrival, it was predicted that he would be a king sent to us. Today, we not only celebrate this king, but we celebrate what his birth stands for, a gift from God to his people so that the relationship between God and his people would even be possible. Yahweh sent us a child, his son, whom he knew would die so that we would have eternal life with our Creator and our God. Looking at God's actions through my human lens, I can't imagine how hard that must have been. First, he created us. Then we were separated from him by sin. Then he decides to restore the relationship, and he will send his son, and in human form, to invite us into his kingdom. All the while knowing that his son would have to give up his life. Can you imagine? I can't. During this past almost 2 years, we have been fighting with a virus that is everywhere in this world. This virus has changed our lives, and we seem to be constantly on the edge of wondering, what's next? The one thing that has remained constant during this time of pandemic is that Yahweh, our God, is with us always. As we wait for the what is next, that feeling of waiting is also a feeling we should recognize as we wait for Christ's return. Last Sunday, Arnie shared a line that went something like this: in faith we wait, but Mary and Joseph in faith acted. If we apply this to our journey, either alone or in community, we will always be part of God, and he will be part of our story. So God's greatest gift to us is his son, his son's life, death, and resurrection. The greatest gift we can give to our Yahweh is our love, to love him with all of our heart, our soul, and our mind. This evening, Rachel and I are going to be sharing a story with you that is written by Paul L. Mayer. It is called The Very First Christmas. Before we start the program, I would like to open with a word of prayer, and this prayer comes from Saint Ephraim from Syria. Following the prayer, I will invite the music team up to lead us in one of my favorite songs, I love to tell the story. Let's pray. Today, as we think of hope you bring, we also think of those who are grieving the loss of a family member. Annie Schoenvetter and her two children and their families as they grieve the loss of Jürgen on December the 23rd. We also grieve with those who are spending this Christmas without a loved one for the first time as we are celebrating the time of your son's birth. We grieve with those who have lost a job or income during this highly emotional time of year. Then there are those who are struggling with health and finances as single parents, like Jennifer, who phoned me yesterday in the office. Yet, with these sad and heavy thoughts, we want to turn to you to see the light that you have sent us. With this hope, we know that all will be healed, all will come together in your kingdom. We also want to celebrate with those who are celebrating your birth for the first time, and there is a newness to this celebration. Help us to always have the excitement of children as we approach this time of year. In closing, I'm going to share the words from Saint Ephraim. The feast day of your birth resembles you, Lord, because it brings joy to all humanity. Old people and infants alike enjoy your day. Your day is celebrated from generation to generation. Kings and emperors may pass away, and the festivals to commemorate them soon lapse, but your festival will be remembered until the end of time. Your day is a means and a pledge of peace, and your birth brings heaven and earth together, and we are reconciled. Since you come from heaven to earth on that day, you forgave our sins and wiped away our guilt. You gave us so many gifts on the day of your birth, a treasure chest of spiritual medicines for the sick, spiritual light for the blind, a cup of salvation for the thirsty, a bread of life for the hungry. And in the winter, when trees are bare, you give us the most succulent spiritual fruit. In the frost, when the earth is barren, you bring new hope to our souls. Thank you, Lord God, for the many gifts you have given us, especially the birth of your Son. Amen.
Good evening. As our singing happens to complement the story that will be shared with us through the evening, we will just remain seated while we sing. So just enjoy singing from where you are. I love to tell the story.
Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, because I know it is true. It satisfies my longings, as nothing else could do. I love to tell the story, will be my theme.
So our story begins with a crash. Chris wanted to know everything about everything. At school, his teachers sometimes called him Christopher Question Mark because he was always raising his hand in class to ask for more information, and more information was never enough. Chris still liked bedtime stories, to be sure, but he was always a little disappointed that fairy tales and such never really happened. From now on, he wanted to hear stories about real people and real things that really happened. So the week before Christmas, Christopher's mother had an idea. She did a little reading on her own. Then she bought a simple nativity set and placed it by her son's bed. And that evening at bedtime, she said,
"Now, Christopher, you said you wanted to hear real stories, not something made up."
"Right, Mom."
"Well, Christmas is coming. Would you like to hear the true story of the first Christmas?"
"Oh, Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus? I think I already know it."
"Maybe not everything, my boy, but let's try you out." "All right. Who is the first person mentioned in the second chapter of Luke, his gospel, the famous story about the birth of Jesus?"
"The Virgin Mary?"
"Close, but she's in chapter one. It's Caesar Augustus. Here, let's read it together." "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria, and everyone was sent to his own town to register."
"Was our month of August named after that Augustus?"
"Yes, indeed, smart guy. Just as July was named for his great uncle, Julius Caesar. Augustus was the first of the Roman emperors. Some say he was the best. He brought peace and great prosperity to the whole empire, even to far-off Palestine where Mary and Joseph lived. And Chris, I think the reason Luke mentions Caesar Augustus first in the Christmas story is for exactly the same reason that you asked me to tell you true stories from now on and not fairy tales. God wants us to know that all of this really happened. That it isn't just a story somebody dreamed up. Everyone knows about the great Augustus and about the way he counted and taxed his people in the empire."
"What was all that business about going back to hometowns to register?"
"Well, nowadays we don't have to register in our neighborhood. Sorry, nowadays we have to register to vote, don't we? So Joseph had to go back to his hometown, Bethlehem, to register for the census. Here, you read on."
"So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. Why didn't Mary go along?"
"She did, Christopher. Read first, ask questions later."
"Oh. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child."
Hey, John, we missed a song, and I don't think we want to miss any tonight. So let's go back to "What Child Is This" for the one verse.
"What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, who angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch a keeping? Is this is Christ the King, whom shepherds watch
Irmgard, this is a newer song for most of us, but it might be familiar to some. Irmgard will play through it once, and then we will sing it through twice.
Now, wait a minute. Don't people have to get married first and then have children?
Well, that's the way it's supposed to be. But Joseph was not the father of this baby. The father was not a man.
What? Who was the father then?
The father of this baby was God himself.
God was the father? But why?
You see, Chris, when God first made people, he made them in his image, perfect, like himself. But when Adam and Eve disobeyed God, sin came into the world. God's love is so great, he planned to save us by sending his son to become one of us and give his life for us. The greatest thing you'll ever learn, Chris, is that God became a human being in Jesus Christ. Yes, in that little baby that Mary was expecting.
God in a baby. How do we even know that?
From his word, from the extraordinary things Jesus did when he grew up. But why did Jesus...
But why did God choose Mary? How old was she and where did she live?
Okay, one question at a time. The last first. Mary came from a town called Nazareth up in Galilee that was in the north country of Palestine. It was a beautiful area, mountains, hills, and fruitful valleys, and a huge lake too. The Sea of Galilee is what they called it.
Was it as big as Lake Tahoe in California?
Almost. And Mary's age, we don't know for sure, but in those days, girls got engaged and married at about 16 or 17. Their husbands were a little older. They had to build up a family nest egg before thinking of marriage.
But why did God choose Mary to be Jesus' mother and not someone else?
Well, we don't really have all the answers, but why not Mary? In the first chapter of this gospel, Luke tells us how the angel Gabriel announced the awesomeness and the awesome news about Jesus to Mary. Luke calls her a girl who was highly favored in God's sight. She agreed to become Jesus' mother in total faith and trust in God. What a marvelous young woman she was.
Well, then, what about Joseph?
Joseph, God tells us, was a carpenter. A book I looked at said the Greek word for carpenter in the New Testament, tekton, can mean any craftsman, not only a carpenter, but maybe even a stone cutter. Both he and Mary were descended from the royal line of King David in the Old Testament.
So they were royalty? Prince and princess, just like in fairy tales?
No, hardly that. King David married quite a few wives and had children by them. So many children and people at that time of the first Christmas were actually related to King David. But here, I'll read on. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son.
The baby was born. Was it morning or night? Was it actually December 25th the year one?
We really don't know the exact date or time, but it was probably late afternoon or evening. You'll learn while we read on. And December the 25th, I understand, was named the date for Christmas more than 300 years after Jesus was born. So it might not be the exact date, but we do know that Jesus was born around 5 BC and not the year one.
Wait a minute. Jesus was born 5 years before Christ? That doesn't make any sense.
I knew you'd say that. About 500 years after Jesus was born, a Christian monk redid the calendar in the form we still use today, but he was mistaken by 4 or 5 years. So we know that about 2,000 years ago, probably sometime between July and December, Jesus was born. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now, a manger, Chris, is a feeding trough for animals.
I know, just like the one we have for our horses. So, Jesus was born in a stable?
God's word doesn't tell us that it was a stable, but since Luke uses the word manger, we assume that it was. One of the earliest church fathers wrote that Jesus was born in a cave that was used as a stable. The area around Bethlehem today has many such places.
Have they ever found the cave where Jesus was born?
Probably so. For at least the last 1,900 years, Christians have pointed to a cave or a grotto beneath the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem as the very place where Jesus was born.
I'd love to see that. But still, a stable is a miserable place to have a baby. If you're not a cow or a horse, that is. Why couldn't they have stayed with relatives or friends or at least in like a motel?
Aha! I think you answered your own question. Remember our vacation last summer when Dad kept driving into the evening and we didn't call ahead for reservations?
Yes.
Remember how all the hotels that night had no vacancy signs?
Mm-hmm.
It could have been something like that. We do know that when the wise men arrived in Bethlehem, later on, Mary, Joseph, and Jesus were living in a house, not a cave or a stable. It's clear they found a better place to stay after Jesus was born.
Ah, just like all the vacancy signs we saw the next morning on our trip.
Right, you are.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified.
But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
The shepherds terrified. They should have been glad to be part of the Christmas story.
Think, Chris, you're going about your business at night when the sky suddenly opens up, light pierces the darkness, and a dazzling being you've never seen before starts talking to you.
I guess you're right. It's a wonder the shepherds didn't lose it.
Especially after what followed next. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." Left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Oh, tell it all.
Christopher, is St. Luke's story of the very first Christmas.
Wait. What about this piece?
Oh, yes, the Magi. Well, they're part of the story, but they come on a little later.
Okay, so it's like they're part of Jesus' story, but not actually part of the night he was born?
You're right. You've got it. Remember, it's more than just a story or a tall tale. All of this really happened.
But how did Luke know all of this stuff? Was he there? He didn't say he was in the cave with Mary and Joseph, did he?
No.
Then if he wasn't there, how could he ever write about it?
That's a really good question, my young scholar. Let's see if you can find the answer. It's in the last part of the Christmas story.
The shepherds went away spreading the word about Jesus? Maybe Luke heard it from them?
Well, perhaps many years later. But look again. Who else could have told the story?
Oh, yes. Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. So maybe Mary told Luke all about what had happened.
Exactly. Some people think that Mary told Luke what happened many years before. I told you she was an extraordinary woman, and God himself told Luke the words he wanted written about his son. Now it's time for sleep, Chris.
There's one thing I know for sure. Real stories, and especially God's story, are way better than fairy tales.
For our last congregational song, let us all stand and sing all of To Us a Child of Hope is Born.
Before we head on our way and close off the service, just a couple of things. One is that want to thank everyone who has helped with putting the program together. There were lots of people involved, from the music team to the ladies' chorus that will be singing our final number, to Rachel and to Joel in the office, and then to Julie, who was here Wednesday setting everything up, and then Terry and John doing the projection for us, and Barb and her sons, Nicholas and William, playing some prelude music for us. So it's definitely a community project. So thank you to all of you who have helped us make this evening so wonderful. As we were telling the story, I was looking out through the double doors to the back, and I actually noticed it was snowing. I don't know if it's still snowing, but Herb's nodding his head that it is. It makes us think a little bit of that romantic Christmas, right? We don't often get white Christmases here, but it looks like we might have some whiteness for this Christmas. So after the special number, I'm going to do a prayer. Then there will be the special number. If you have children in your family that are grade 3 or younger, we have a copy of the storybook that we've purchased so that you can add that to your kids' library at home. So if you want to just come up and grab a copy from Rachel or myself, please do that. We should have enough based on kind of the head count we did, so you can do that after the song. The closing prayer is a prayer written by the poet Robert Louis Stevenson. Loving Father, help us remember the birth of Jesus, that we may share in the songs of the angels, the gladness of the shepherds, and the worship of the wise men. Close the door of hate and open the door of love all over the world. Let kindness come with every gift and good desires with every greeting. Deliver us from evil by the blessing which Christ brings, and teach us to be merry with clear hearts. May the Christmas morning make us happy to be thy children, and the Christmas evening bring us to our beds with grateful thoughts, forgiving and forgiven, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
We would like to sing Silent Night as our closing song. You're welcome to hum along or sing along. The first verse is going to be in German, and then we'll do all four verses in English.